It is indeed a great pleasure to welcome you all tonight to the National Liberty Museum for this version or this special event in our Stan and Arlene Ginsburg series. As Alan said, it's going to be a little different tonight, but all of us at FPRI are delighted that you could join us here today. The panel is in the spirit of the Ginsburg series, an effort to bring complex questions to a broader public. But instead of merely offering one perspective tonight, we're going to present at least three perspectives, maybe four if you include me, and many more when we include all of you in the discussion as well. We want to encourage both a learned and a spirited conversation exploring a part of the world that is the cradle of three great world religions, each promising its believers peace and harmony with the universe, which is also the site of some of the world's most violent, most bitter, and most intractable conflicts, the Middle East. It's not easy to say completely new things about the Middle East, although one can say many interesting things about the Middle East. And I think we're going to do both of those things tonight. But the Middle East itself is a famously imprecise umbrella term. Depending on the speaker, depending on the audience, depending on the presenter, it can cover locations that run from Casablanca to Kashmir, from Trebizond to Aden, depending on who you're speaking to. But its definition is as flexible as its presence in world headlines appears permanent. The combination of its cultural, political, and economic significance has guaranteed the Middle East a primary place in contemporary geopolitical debates and in the attention of American governments. No matter how many theorists, strategists, policymakers, or presidents may proclaim their desire to pivot or reorganize or reprioritize to focus on other regions, the conflicts in the Middle East continue to reverberate and draw the attention of the world. The existing states in the Middle East today, monarchies or republics, religious or secular, all grapple with the challenges of reform and modernization while also trying to defend themselves from demands for radical social and political upheaval. Meanwhile, governments and publics outside the region argue among themselves whether it's more dangerous to stay out and risk the emergence of failed states or to intervene with grand plans and risk provoking attacks. And attacks not only on troops wearing those mythical boots on the ground, but even civilians in locations far away, be they Russian tourists, French concert goers, or Californian civil servants. Worst of all, festering and unresolved conflicts in the region are wreaking havoc on the lives of millions of innocents who want nothing more than to be able to live in peace. Tonight, as we speak, another generation faces a bleak future in refugee camps or among the ruins of once proud cities. Worse yet, many face the prospect of permanent exile in faraway lands with different languages and cultures, to become objects of suspicion and even hate, with no home and no future, easy prey for the radical forces seeking new recruits to provide new fuel for rounds of violence and reprisal. It can all be pretty grim. Now, ironically, right, in this holiday season, many eyes turn toward the Middle East and to the hopes that so many of us draw from stories of a particular family who had to travel far from home to find a place to safely rest. Yet for all our hopes, peace on earth remains as elusive as the search for men and women of goodwill. We may hope for miracles and revelations, but the problems of the present can only be resolved through a willingness to understand the roots of current conflict and the practical costs and challenges of any possible solutions. All of which is what brings us here tonight. How did the Middle East get into its current state? Where are the most and least stable locations? Is it possible for outsiders to help develop a new peaceful order? If not, how likely is it that the locals will be willing or able to do it? These questions and yours will guide us tonight in our discussions with our guests, Samuel Helfont, Tally Helfont, and Andrew Spath. Samuel Helfont is a Robert A. Fox Fellow in FPRI's program in the Middle East and a postdoctoral lecturer in the University of Pennsylvania's International Relations Program, holder of a PhD from Princeton University's Near Eastern Studies Department, where he wrote his dissertation on Saddam Hussein's use of religion to entrench his authoritarian regime. Dr. Helfont is the author of Yusuf al-Qaradawi, Islam and Modernity, as well as the FPRI monograph, The Sunni Divide, Understanding Politics and Terrorism in the Arab Middle East. Last but surely not least, Dr. Helfont served in the United States Navy, is an Iraq War veteran who served two deployments in the Middle East. Tally Helfont. Tally Helfont is the director of the Foreign Policy Research Institute's program on the Middle East, where she focuses on the regional balance of power, the Levant, the Gulf states, and U.S. policy therein. She's also a contributing analyst for Wikistrat's Middle East Desk, a crowdsourcing consultancy. Ms. Helfont has instructed training courses in civil information management to U.S. military civil affairs units and human terrain teams assigned to Iraq and Afghanistan. Her writings have appeared in English, Hebrew, and Arabic, in Orbis, The American Interest, INSS Insight, Al-Mezbar, and Al-Majala, as well as in FPRI's E-Notes and our Geopoliticus blog. Andrew Spath is a fellow in the Foreign Policy Research Institute's program on the Middle East and an instructor at American University's School of International Service. He's a PhD candidate in political science at Rutgers University, where he has taught courses on authoritarian regimes, Middle East politics and security, and Model United Nations, which will certainly come in handy tonight. His current research examines the effects of leadership succession on the relationship between government and society in Jordan and Syria. Andrew Spath was awarded both a David L. Boren Fellowship for the 2012-2013 academic year and also two consecutive Fulbright Fellowships from 2012 to 2014 to support his studies in Jordan. We are delighted to have the three of them with us today. So now let's get to the conversation, shall we? So welcome to our speakers. So I want to start with the first question to you, Tally Helfont, and that is a college student famously accosted Jeb Bush by shouting at him with the comment, "Your brother created ISIS." Recognizing the long and twisting road from 2003 to the present, how should people try to understand the relationship between current problems in the Middle East and American foreign policy in the last decade? Like, is it our fault?
Well, let's put it this way. It's not all our fault, but it's not all their fault either. I think our histories are very much entwined, and from the moment that we decided in the post-9/11 period to make another foray into the Middle East, that was the beginning of our shared histories. Now, I think that in the region, there's a tendency to kind of deflect agency, and conspiracy theories are very common. But at the same time, we have done a lot of soul searching since 9/11 and have come to the conclusions that there were some missteps on our own part. So I think that you can basically track the trajectories of first the Bush administration, the Obama administration, trying to respond to various developments in the region with whatever their particular silver bullet was, and you still have the region responding in its own way and phenomena creeping up that we could not have dreamt of, constantly changing the playing field. So I think the answer is complicated.
Complicated. Well, it's good. That's a good place to start. Sam, I wanted to flip that question around. Among the things that you've worked on are issues of sectarianism, and to what extent are the problems in the region the result of completely endogenous internal developments within the Islamic world? And I'm not just thinking of sectarianism between Sunnis and Shiites, but also the roles of other forms of Islam in the region.
Yeah, I mean, I would, as Holly said, certainly the West has played a role in stirring things up, but I guess I lean more towards the idea that a lot of this is coming out of the Middle East itself and is a sort of response more towards modernity than it is towards sort of Western foreign policy. And sectarianism is the sort of, output of that, right? I mean, when Europe was stirred up, nationalism. Nationalism emerged, right, as sort of power came down towards the popular level. In the Middle East, when things were stirred up in the 20th century, especially now the late 20th century, and then in early 21st century, a lot of people thought nationalism was going to come out of that, but sectarianism came out of that, and I think it's still a similar process, which would have happened, regardless of what we did or didn't do in the region.
So Jordan, or I'm going to ask you a question about Jordan, Andrew, because this is what I wanted to get into before. We're going to talk about a lot of states that are in the midst of a great deal of upheaval. But Jordan is an interesting case. It's a state that is, at least from an outside perspective, is relatively stable. It is surrounded by some pretty chaotic places and is facing the problems of dealing with refugees and also dealing with calls for its own political reform and development. So how does Jordan see, what is Jordan's place in the contemporary Middle East?
Well, Jordan lines up quite closely with the United States and its strategic objectives in the region. It's certainly bearing the brunt of a severe refugee crisis. Not the most refugees, but per capita relative to its own population, it's bearing the largest number of refugees of the other states. There are about 2.2 million in Turkey, over a million, probably about a million and a quarter in Lebanon. Jordan, estimates range, the king generally talks about 1.4 million. Other people have it less than a million. Regardless, it's a heck of a lot of people who are in dire need of assistance and support, many of whom are in refugee camps, but the vast majority of whom are actually in the regular populace, mm-hmm. Vying for jobs that regular Jordanians are wanting to compete for and have, and dealing with all sorts of economic issues. And so I think kind of on the taking a more humanist perspective to it, that's Jordan's most critical challenge at the moment. The IMF has just reduced its projections for its economy for the third time this year. And so there are very serious issues in terms of how this humanitarian issue drags on the country itself, not to mention the geostrategic issues with its neighbors and the kinds of risks that they pose, whether it's ISIS or worrying about kind of ingrown extremism or other things.
All right. If I could just follow
please.
Up, I would say, from the outside, Jordan may seem stable relative to the mm-hmm. other countries, but mm-hmm. I think if you did a search over the past 4 decades, you would find scholarly articles and State Department reports about the terminal instability of Jordan, constantly being on the brink because of X, because of Y, whether it is the internal dynamics between the East Jordanians or tribal Jordanians and Jordanians of Palestinian descent or Palestinians, or whether the idea of not having oil and depending on external funds. So I think that it's kind of like instability light.
It's interesting. Persistent instability can often be a sign of life, right? There's an old German proverb, but tot gesagte leben länger, right? The people who are constantly said they're dead, they live longer. But actually, speaking of states and stability and all that stuff, Tally, I wanted to ask you about the role of the Gulf monarchies in all this, right? The news today about Saudi Arabia announcing that they're going to head a new coalition to fight terrorism. How would you characterize the role of the Gulf monarchies in the contemporary Middle East?
Well, I would say that on the one hand, what have we been asking from the Saudis? Step up, take a leadership role. You have created some of the problems, start to fix them. But on the other hand, a grand coalition of 34 countries to fight a tactic, terrorism, we know from our own history is a very difficult thing to do. It's an amorphous, vague label that in some regards perhaps gives the Saudis a carte blanche to intervene where they see fit and stay out where they don't see fit. It doesn't address any of the underlying religious issues at play. And many analysts would also argue that this is Mohammed bin Salman, the king's son and defense minister, the second in line's attempt to kind of rally people under another flag, since the war in Yemen is going so poorly. So maybe this is sort of their motherhood and apple pie. Everyone is complaining about terrorism. The Saudis will lead the grand coalition of Muslim majority states. Now, it was announced today. You didn't see many other leaders speaking out. You didn't see a big photo op with the leaders of the country. So I think we have to wait and see what it means. The Saudis have shown a great reluctance to get too involved in the ISIS issue because they have been very preoccupied with the Yemen issue. So we'll see how much of it is optics and how much of it is real.
And Sam, in your last deployment to the region, you were in the Gulf, right?
That's right.
Is that right? And I wanted to ask a broad question about American military policy in the region, but I will start actually smaller and just say, what is the military cooperation between the United States and the Gulf states like right now when it comes to dealing with, say, Islamic State?
So I guess I am still a year out of date. I got back the last time in September of 2014, but I was there for the summer when the whole ISIS thing kicked off.
Right.
And I would say the cooperation is excellent. Well, you know, excellent. It's better than it's ever been. At least it was when I was there. They were willing to participate, and they did participate, and they were bombing, you know, in a coalition with the United States, which really hasn't ever happened on that level before. And it was really the result of sort of fortuitous timing, because the U.S. was trying to give the Gulf powers the capability to sort of take care of themselves when we left.
Mm-hmm.
And then it turned out that, you know, these capabilities we gave them turned out to be very, very useful. It wasn't simply the important capabilities weren't simply bombs or, you know, new technologies, which that was part of it, but it was really technology which allowed them to cooperate with each other and allowed them to cooperate with us.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw that. In the operations. I would say the issues that the Gulf countries have in terms of cooperation isn't cooperation with the United States. They all love the United States. I mean, and they love working with us anyway. Whatever you see in the news among politicians is, you know, there might be disagreement between the White House and the Saudi royal family, but on the military-to-military level, the cooperation was, and from what I understand, it remains very strong. The issue that the Gulf has is the cooperation with each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they've always had issues. They sort of trust us, but they don't trust each other. And that's always been the sort of hindrance, and probably will continue to be.
This puts a lot of pressure on American policy. If the United States is looking to pivot or reorganize or reprioritize, how can the United States both leave and stay in the region?
Well, yeah, it's not simple. The U.S. is trying to sort of, not just in the Gulf, but all over the world,
mm-hmm.
The U.S. is trying to sort of empower other countries to do things that the U.S. maybe used to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
We saw this just before ISIS took over northern Iraq at a West Point speech that Obama gave, where he basically laid this strategy out. And he said, you know, fighting terrorism and these other issues around the world, he felt that locals knew the populations better than Americans ever could, which is true. You know, you talk to Americans who were involved in 2003, and no one knew what was going on, and no one knew what they were stepping into. The Iraqis know what's going on, and they can probably deal with it much more efficiently than we can. And if they screw it up, you know, it's sort of their it's their problem and not ours. So, in some ways, that's what they're doing. But it's a problem because none of these countries around the world, nobody is as capable as the United States. And to even have some sort of self-defense, they're going to need to cooperate much more than they're doing now, which means sharing secrets,
mm-hmm.
which they don't want to share with each other, opening themselves up. You know, displaying their vulnerabilities to other countries who they don't necessarily like, and that's a hurdle that they're eventually going to have to get over if they're going to cooperate. What the U.S. can do is simply sell them the equipment to do it, push them in that direction, and also show them that we are going to leave.
Now, ironically, I would say a generation ago, right when the United States was trying to get out of a long and protracted conflict. An administration came up with the bright idea of encouraging local, regional friends to take over for the United States. President Nixon called that Vietnamization, and he called it the Nixon Doctrine. And so we're still looking for allies. Now, one of the problems there, and this is what I'm going to, because I think, Andrew, this is where I want to go with you, that what the United States did in the 1970s was identify local powers, many of whom were themselves authoritarian regimes. in the name of local stability, very famously Iran. We'll talk about Iran in a little bit, but I want to talk in general about how can an American policy that is expecting or wanting local states in the Middle East to preserve order, how can the United States both want order and want to encourage democratic development? Or do we have to just ignore the prospects of democratic development and rely on our authoritarian partners to maintain order?
I mean, I would suggest that the former trumps the latter in, uh-huh. in this situation, uh-huh. in which security is the primary concern. Mm-hmm. That's been the case in a number of different areas in our relationship previously with Turkey, and our relationship, of course, with all sorts of different regimes throughout the Middle East. Under certain conditions, we are willing to accept the domestic political structures of these countries. We will nudge and we will urge and we will rhetorically kind of speak to some of these, the importance of liberalization or marches towards democracy or what have you. But the security and strategic interests generally trump those things. One thing I was going to say about the coalition, mm-hmm. And I think this really fits into the question as well, is that what I'm interested to see from this coalition, as Tali said, is kind of a wait and see kind of thing, given how new the news is right, countering terrorism is something that can function in all sorts of different ways and in all sorts of different places. And so the extent to which this is going to be happening within individual countries throughout the region that Saudi Arabia is meant to try to administer or lead might be interesting, or the degree to which it's directed towards Syria itself will be really interesting to see. I assume we would have more of the latter in this instance, or at least that's the way it would be framed. And in that case, I'm wondering what that means for the current efforts that the United States has been involved in with Kurdish Peshmerga forces and the other Syrian Democratic Forces, as they're called, the forces that are composed primarily of the Peshmerga Kurdish forces, as well as some Sunni forces in eastern Syria, Yazidis and Christians as well. And I mean, in brief, one of the things that we've seen recently is that as these small coalition of forces move through eastern Syria and take back some of the land and create problems for ISIS, some of the Sunni population in these areas are a little bit concerned. They're a little bit wary because of the degree to which this coalition of forces is composed of Kurds, of which they don't have a lot of trust, frankly. And so it seems to me that the timing is ripe, or at least perhaps this is why Saudi Arabia was able to manage this coalition at this moment. The time would be ripe for them to enter in to try to pacify some of that Sunni skepticism in eastern Syria and try to kind of lead the way a little bit more and less reliant on the Kurdish forces.
I'll add something about these Kurds too, because this is a story that's not really getting out in the West. We all like to look at the Peshmerga and these wonderful, beautiful women with guns who are secular, and the Yazidi forces and all this, right? They're not the ones actually doing a lot of the fighting. A lot of the fighting is being done by the PKK, which is a terrorist organization. They're Kurdish terrorists. They're a sort of Marxist terrorist, but they're on, U.S. designated terrorist organization. And their allies, which sometimes take a different name, but they're really PKK people. And this is where the muscle is coming in. So this is where a lot of the reluctance by a lot of people to see these Kurdish victories, because they're not the victories of our friends, the Kurds, that helped us, after 2003 or mm-hmm. in the 1990s. And those Kurds were dysfunctional in themselves. But the idea of this Kurdish group being some sort of silver bullet that's going to, these are the good guys. It's a much, much more murky story mm-hmm. than what we're seeing in the press. And that's why you'll probably see a lot of reluctance on a lot of different hands to see a Kurdish victory. It's not that simply people dislike the Kurds, although there is that too. you know, the Kurds themselves are not as sure. Well organized.
Well, and Tali, I want to bring you in here too, because we talked about the Gulf states. We talk about as we circle around the question of how to deal with IS, which we are going to get to. But I want to ask about one other. If Saudi Arabia wants to put itself forward as the leader of the Sunnis in this struggle, there used to be another state in the Middle East that was essentially the leader of the Sunnis and was the United States' best friend in the Arab world, and that was Egypt.
Yeah,
what happened? What is the situation with the United States and Egypt, and what role is Egypt currently playing in the region?
Our former best friend. Well, I think the situation in Egypt is that they're very much looking inward at the moment, very stability focused. They probably weathered one of the rockiest sets of transitions. Now, they didn't come apart and break apart, and people aren't saying, what is the future of Egypt in the way that they are Syria? But they realize that this tension between Islamist elements, be it the Muslim Brotherhood or the Noor parties, the Salafis, or even people who are more extreme than that along the lines of Islamic State and some of the elements that they are fighting in the Sinai, and whoever their core constituency, these large numbers of under 30 who will be the next Egypt, they have this tension and they're trying to work it out. I think President Sisi is very much Mubarak, but is kind of beefed up his authoritarianism in order to secure the state. And I don't think they're that interested in what's going on beyond their borders. There was a little bit of indication in 2014 that they were concerned with the Islamists in Libya and therefore allowed the Emiratis to use their airspace to conduct some airstrikes in Libya. There's obviously cooperation with the Israelis in Sinai to deal with that Islamist problem, but otherwise they seem pretty much turned inward. And so, you know, the relationship with Egypt in various times has been rocky. It's been cooler at some times and warmer at other times. But I think at the moment they're not poised to be a dominant force in the region. And I think that the stepped up role that we're seeing the Saudis and some of the other Gulf countries play, whether it's simply funding proxies or through other activities, is kind of a new thing.
Mm-hmm. Related to that, now I just want a quick follow-up on Egypt, since tonight there's going to be a presidential debate. And one of the questions on which Republican challengers tend to attack the Obama administration is the mishandling of Egypt during the Arab Spring, that we were too quick to abandon Mubarak, that we were too naive about the Islam, the Muslim Brotherhood, and so therefore we've been forced by circumstance to re-embrace authoritarianism in Egypt. Leaving aside American policy, I'm curious, does the Egyptian regime hold it against the Obama administration that they feel like the Obama administration made mistakes in the aftermath of the Arab Spring?
Last time I talked to Sisi, he didn't mention it.
He didn't mention it. Yeah, that's good. Egyptian public opinion?
I would say that there's a consensus in the Arab world that the United States sold out its friend, Egypt being the first one. Mm-hmm. I think that there's a pretty much a consensus in the States and in other countries that our Egypt policy or the way we reacted to these very tumultuous developments was poor on all counts, and we followed each misstep with a misstep. And mm-hmm. at certain times, we were chastising kind of a very close ally at a time where our allies were really, you could count them on less than one hand. I mean, the region was changing so rapidly. And so I think, yeah, in the United States, we have this tension between democracy and authoritarianism. But when it comes to the Middle East, the United States has a few core goals that it wants to achieve, and it has based its partnerships on those goals and not on the humanitarian behavior of those actors and not on, you know, or any of these other things that we care about as Americans, that we talk about a lot and that Egyptians care about too. But in terms of bilateral relations between two countries, they have been based on strategy, on a few core tenets, and that seems to be, on the whole, undisturbed. Mm-hmm. The major areas in which we worked, like access to the Suez Canal, the Camp David Accords are still in place. Cooperation in counterterrorism, maritime free movement. So a lot of the main things are still there. The relationship itself, I think, is kind of maybe we're on a break.
That's where trouble happens. That's where anybody watches.
Given that this is a state that went through a revolution and a coup to reinstate the former regime, and the same SCAF force, Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, Given the tumultuousness of that, it is rather remarkable that most of the pieces remain in place in terms of the bilateral relationship that exists. But this is, you know, this is one other case case where that underlies some of the different strategic interests among the Gulf parties. Mm-hmm. You know, Egypt's relationship with Saudi Arabia and the Emirates is very different than its relationship with Qatar and some of the other countries of the region. And I think in terms of those relationships, there's still a lot to be seen in mm-hmm. terms of how those relationships develop. But in terms of the relationship with the United States, despite what kind of interpersonal differences there might be between administrations, the core tenets of the relationship still stand.
They still stand. Sam, I wanted to follow up on when you were talking about the Kurds, it brings up another important thought that we can throw into the conversation. That is that for many Americans, the Middle East means Islam, yes, but it especially means Arabs. Right, the terms are often used. People think of the people of America. They talk about the Middle East. They're talking about Arab states. Yet there are important Islamic powers with interests in the region who are not Arabs. Right, Turkey and Iran. I think we'll start with Turkey because we'll have a lot to say about Turkey and a lot to say about Iran. But I want to ask you about how do you judge Turkey's part in the role that it is playing in the contemporary Middle East? How does this reflect what the Turks want, and is what they want constructive for the region?
Wow, this is a complex issue.
It is. You break it down any way you like.
So, first of all, I would say they haven't been very constructive. Mm-hmm. They haven't been very constructive, and it's actually probably, if I was to say, there's one issue that could blow everything up for the United States and really create huge issues. It's Turkey, mm-hmm. Because as a sort of legacy, you know, Turkey is a NATO ally, right? And therefore, we have certain bonds with Turkey and certain commitments with Turkey. And as we've seen, you know, I think this shooting down of the Russian plane was quite reckless. They've been doing the same thing in the Mediterranean over the last few days. If you've been following, with sort of Russian and Turkish naval ships have been playing this sort of chicken game. Mm-hmm. And when Turkey says it's going to help, it kind of does the same thing that Russia does, right? You know, Russia says, oh, we're going to go bomb ISIS, and they sort of make a left turn and go bomb, you know, the more moderate forces. Well, Turkey did the same thing, you know, last summer. They said, oh, we're going to go bomb ISIS, and they sort of make a left turn and go bomb the Kurds. And they don't really mm-hmm. care about ISIS. Some people say they're even, you know, might be supporting them, right, because they prefer ISIS to the Kurds, partly mm-hmm. because of this PKK, this PKK issue. But other than that, I mean, so in Syria, they're not being very helpful, right? They're supporting people who we don't necessarily like. They're not really supporting the people who we do like. But throughout the region, you know, the leader Erdogan is a sort of mild Islamist, but he's aligned with, you know, Muslim Brotherhood type forces in the region. In Egypt, for example, he doesn't have good relations with the regime in Egypt right now because of his support for the Muslim Brotherhood. He doesn't have good relations with the Israeli government right now, you know, for a whole bunch of other reasons. So, you know, he's a bit of a hothead, mm-hmm. and he does some dangerous things, and he's sort of in charge the way. He's a kind of a mirror image of Putin. He's a kind of Middle Eastern Putin. And you have these two guys butting heads together. It can be very, very dangerous.
And he has larger visions to restore, used to have larger visions to restore Turkish Ottoman greatness in the region, to be a leader in the Islamic world.
Yeah, that's right. You know, he came to power as the sort of, you know, Turkey had been facing the EU and wanting to get in the EU for a long time. And the EU sort of rejected them. And he came to power, I guess his party in 2002, I think it was, sort of shifting the focus back towards the Muslim world. Mm-hmm. That rhetoric, has died down a little bit, mm-hmm. but they are very much involved in Syria, in fact, and in Iraq. I mean, Iraq just filed a complaint because Turkish troops just sort of, I mean, I don't invaded, I guess you could say, right? They just came down across the Iraqi border and set up shop in some of these northern Iraqi towns. I heard this morning that some of them had left, but only after a huge huge stink was made by Baghdad. So they clearly see their interest in the Middle East. Their policy of sort of neo-Ottomanism hit its probably peak during the Arab Spring, when you saw a lot of these Islamist groups taking over different capitals in the wake of the Arab Spring. That wave is sort of crested, and I think neo-Ottomanism sort of crested with it.
With it, good.
Although I might just add that I think that what you see with both Turkey and Iran is this overbloated sense of their place in today's world. I think the legacy of the Ottoman Empire is that Turkey sees itself, that everyone should follow Turkey, and I think that's Iran's deal too. So a lot of their behavior can be understood through this sort of, in one regard, megalomania of one leader, in another regard, sort of what this, the Aryan legacy of Iran and sort of their place in the world, so.
Well, Erdogan tried initially too, I mean, if we talk about the relationship with Syria, in response to the original protests and uprising that occurred there, he tried to get Assad to throw a bone to the reformists and especially to the Muslim Brotherhood to try to allow them back into politics. First of all, because it would serve Turkey's purposes and Erdogan's personal interests in kind of aligning a little bit with the Muslim Brotherhood itself. But also to have Syria stabilized, right? There's a sense of authoritarian learning that's supposed to happen after you have a couple of different revolutions going on elsewhere. And as we know, Assad and his government went the opposite direction. And I think, you know, that definitely caused some serious issues with their relationship with the Turks, to where Erdogan decided to do a 180 and say, okay, if you're not going to follow our advice or our lead when we've tried to open up our relations with you and offer some good advice on how to stabilize the situation, then we are going to advocate for your demise. And essentially that's what happened in terms of getting in bed with a number of Islamist elements in the rebel opposition to Assad's regime.
What was interesting about this, though, is you're exactly right, but there was another piece. Is before that Turkey and Syria, since the fall of the Ottoman Empire, had a sort of antagonistic relationship. The Syrians viewed themselves as anti-Turks, right? This is their sort of, they viewed the Ottoman Empire as this colonialist empire that they had sort of thrown off, right? And Erdogan wanted to reverse that, and he was really reaching out to Assad and making good friends with Assad. They had opened up the borders. They'd created a no visa program between the two countries. And Erdogan, and this is where I think this could be dangerous. It seems that he took this not just as a geopolitical, but as a personal affront that Assad didn't listen to him.
Yeah, yes.
And
style.
Therefore, he was going to come down on Assad as a matter of pride and honor on the personal level, which I think is can be kind of dangerous.
Yeah, I could definitely see that. Well, now we're circling down to the thing the things that are on everybody's minds. And this is the problem of Syria, the problem of the Islamic State, right? They are clearly related to each other. We talk about these external forces. We talk about the uprising in Syria. Is it possible to resolve the problem of ISIS or of the Islamic State as a political entity without resolving the Syrian civil war? And if one has to resolve the Syrian civil war first, is it possible to resolve the Syrian civil war and also escort Bashar al-Assad into exile? Tally Helfont.
I just want to say that if you'd like multiple perspectives on this very question, go to FPRI's website, because our authors have written both sides of this coin, if not more. I don't know. I was very much convinced by one argument that said that, in order to even begin to deal with the ISIS piece, you have to deal with Syria, you have to deal with Assad. The death toll and the activities that the Assad regime has been carrying out dwarf what the Islamic State has been doing. And one of the reasons that ISIS was able to flourish was not only because of the security vacuum that we created when we left Iraq, but also because of Assad's response in brutalizing, his citizens and the security board creating this space for a Sunni champion to come in. But then I've also read things on the other hand that basically if Assad goes, there's going to be a worse alternative, plus you still have to deal with ISIS. So I think that the Syrian conundrum has been so complicated from the first days that the American administration was considering whether it should intervene through containment, through airstrikes and other things. And I'm just not quite sure what the right thing is. But I think in terms of the Islamic State, even if you root out this iteration of an Islamist terrorist group, there is some real soul searching and real reform that needs to happen kind of at the root level so that the next young people and the next generation is being taught something different. And then I think there's also the economic component. When there are more opportunities for young men in particular, the draw perhaps is not as much, especially after the legacy of so much destruction. But maybe my colleagues have
just
some.
Hop in on this, please. Right? So this is another issue we have in the sort of Western press. ISIS, 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 right? ISIS is a horrible, horrible group, right? I mean, really apocalyptic in their mindset, right? That being said, you know, in all the nasty things that they do, if you're a Syrian, right? Not a Syrian, a Syrian, right? if you're a Syrian,
if you're a Syrian, you're living 3,000 years
or one of these other places, right? Assad has killed something like 7 times more Syrians than ISIS. This is a no-brainer. If you're looking at which side you're going to support, and Assad has done, he's quieter about it. He doesn't, you know, crucify people up on the mountainside, right? But he tortures, he gasses. And the people on the ground in Syria know this, and they know who's going to come and kill them, right? And the chances of you being killed by ISIS are much smaller than your chances of, you know, being bombarded by a Russian or a Syrian jet while you're standing in line to get food. So trying to convince these people on the ground in Syria, which is what you need to do, to go fight ISIS and forget about Assad is a non-starter, right? No one's going to do that. They know who's killing them, and it's not ISIS. Now, could you defeat ISIS? I think you could probably do a lot to degrade ISIS and do this without any help, just by bombing them, right? They're eventually going to run out of hard. They took all this equipment from the Iraqis, right? The American equipment from the Iraqis and from Syria. Eventually, we're going to bomb that stuff into dust, and they're going to be left with just some guns. But ISIS is a symptom, right? Mm-hmm. So you could defeat ISIS, but then some other group's just going to pop up as long as you don't deal with this political situation where the Syrian people are being slaughtered by their own regime.
And yet, any plan that's currently out there that's being discussed about resolving the Syrian situation essentially relies on keeping Bashar al-Assad as president of Syria for the for some period of time, even when people talk about transition.
That's not actually true.
All right, bring it on.
I've been involved in some track two on this for a few years now. Mm-hmm. And people talk about keeping the regime.
Okay.
But the regime is different than Assad himself. And even the Russians will say this. If you press them, they'll talk about the regime, and it sounds like they're talking about Assad.
Right.
But when you press them about it, it's not Assad they're talking about. And the plan, they haven't been able to put all these pieces together yet, but the only plan that seems on the table, that seems at all reasonable to me, is that you knock off a certain level of the regime. Maybe all the flag and general officers have to go, and Assad finds a nice place in Tehran suburb somewhere. But you have the sort of core of this regime, which is somehow at least more acceptable to a critical mass of people on the ground. Mm-hmm. That's basically the only, but leaving that regime in place.
Well, we're going to turn to questions from the audience in just a moment, so get your hands ready to raise. But I have a question that was sent to me by a member who can't be here tonight who wanted to make sure that I ask it. So I want to ask this about the question of fighting ISIS and what the West can do, right? Assuming that the United States is not planning on sending direct troops to fight ISIS directly, can the outside world do more to reduce ISIS through cutting off their funding by destroying their oil facilities or the sources? You mentioned, Sam, that ISIS has a limited supply of equipment, so theoretically the more you bomb it, the more it would go away. But is ISIS vulnerable from the air to be reduced, or can they only be defeated on the ground? I'm gonna ask Andrew first.
Well, there has to be a ground component. That mm-hmm. doesn't mean it needs to be the United States. It doesn't even mean it has to be an external actor. Mm-hmm. But essentially, you can't oust a military in a pseudo-state like IS is without infiltrating its safe havens. Mm-hmm. And so that's an important component of it. But whether that factors into our actual military foreign policy with our troops in particular is a different question. But there are a lot of things that we can do, and they do revolve around kind of realizing where this Islamic State gets a lot of its resources. Mm-hmm. The fact of the matter is, right, oil is a big part of that, and so we've been trying to focus our attention through our proxies on taking back some of their oil capabilities and resources, but they get a lot of their resources and their cash flow from other things that are much harder to get at by dropping bombs from the sky. They tax people. Mm-hmm. That's a significant part of their revenue, like really significant. Like a third or more of their revenue comes from basic taxation through looting. And selling of antiquities and artwork and all sorts of things that pull in millions and millions and millions of dollars, very significant part of their cash flow as well. All sorts of criminal enterprise kinds of things, rackets, kidnapping, just basic thievery and robbery, all sorts of just truly criminal enterprise kinds of things that operate within the territories that they control. And those are the things, essentially those are the things that are much more difficult to get at from,
bombing from the air.
Bombing from the sky.
Do we have a question from the audience? Right here.
Hi. I feel like
make sure you speak directly into the microphone. There you go.
I feel like Mr. Spath brought up a little bit earlier talking about the choice between authoritarian regime and actual development of democracy. And Mr. Spath suggested that the immediate security and stability was of a higher need. But don't we get into a cycle where we saw in Iran, like we saw in Afghanistan, where we take these immediate situations and focus on the security, which then radicalizes the population and gives us the outcome of an ISIS or an Islamic revolution in Iran after we depose Mossadegh, right? We support these authoritarian regimes for the immediate security and stability. But doesn't this give us exactly what we're hoping to avoid in the long run by radicalizing these populations because they see that secular democratic revolution isn't going to be successful because of American foreign policy?
Hmm. What do you think?
Well, I mean, deposing regimes is one thing. I mean, I guess the point that I was making before is less that, wasn't that a process of actually deposing regimes that are authoritarian is a policy that we want to get behind. And those are the things in the examples you raised offer that blowback.
No, no, but we talking about deposing the regime of Mossadegh, that was, over the Shah. We chose the Shah, which was the more authoritarian regime to support against a more democratic regime. Right.
That's us, just quickly. I mean, that's the United States' involvement in a coup to overthrow a regime that was already less authoritarian than the Shah was, or on a democratic footing, you could say. But that's different than what we're looking at throughout the region now, where it's should we prioritize advocating democracy and trying to bring that to a number of these states when they currently are not, or should we prioritize our own strategic security interests during that period, or can we do them simultaneously? I mean, to some extent, it's perhaps a false dichotomy. And it has more to do with prioritization of things. And I think that, if you look at a country like Jordan, it's an authoritarian state, right? It's a monarchy, it's not a democracy, and it's been on a democratic march for 2.5 decades. And that's something that we want to support. We do, frankly, through a lot of civil society involvement and a lot of other things. And you know, throughout the region, you know, the State Department and various officials are involved in urging, you know, opening up political systems, and definitely opening up economic systems. But my observation is that plays second fiddle to immediate security during a very contingent period of time of security interest.
All right, another question from the audience. This young man right here in the front. Your microphone's coming to you. She's behind you.
So my hypothesis is that this problem won't be solved for at least 1,000 years. and that Andrew, you're a very bright guy, but basically you're engaged in mental autoeroticism. I agree with Clint Watts, who says that our priority ought to be to protect our borders. And by the way, our borders are more vulnerable than we realize, because I have a brother-in-law who's a Muslim and who is a good American, and he tells me about what some of his co-religionists in the United States feel about this country, and you'd be surprised. And so my hypothesis is that the U.S. foreign policy ought to be based on A, protecting our borders, and that basically whatever we do in the Middle East, it's going to be one form or another of the same kind of craziness long after my grandchildren are gone.
So is that, if the question is, so I'll summarize that in one question. It's Tally Helfont, why bother? We can't make it better. What do you think? What do you think about that?
Wow.
We live in a fallen world. Things are broken, cannot be put back together.
Yeah. I don't know. I just don't think that in 2016, coming up on 2016, it's possible to be isolationist in that way. I think that we have interest in global trade and global resources and keeping maritime sea lanes open from and unfettered from piracy and terrorism. And it goes beyond whatever altruistic values and mores we want to export around the world. I think it's about getting goods to our shores unfettered and I don't think that the United States, even if it's not the number one hegemon for the rest of, I don't know, the 1,000 years you're talking about, I just don't think that we can put our head in the sand. Now we can try and learn from our mistakes and be smarter, and I hope that we do that. And I hope that the kinds of discussions that we have here and that are had in Washington eventually gets us to a smarter foreign policy, but I don't think that we're able to avoid it.
Good. Back over this way. The microphone is in hand.
Shortly after World War I, when they started carving up the Mideast, there was a school of thought that said they went in the wrong direction in some of those countries and cut through tribes and cut through territories that shouldn't have been dissected. So fast forward to today. Nations or countries are made up of borders. Nations are made up of like-minded people. Do you see in the future a redistribution of the borders in the area?
Sam Helfont, what do you think? Should we have a festival, a convention to redraw the borders of the Middle East?
I mean, so there's a lot that is said about this drawing of the borders. The problem is that there are so many layers of political identity in the Middle East. Tribes is one, Arabs is one, right? So if we said, okay, we're going to cut up Syria now, you know, make it Sunnis and Alawis and all these, then we say, okay, well now we're dividing the Arabs, right? And in 50 years, we can sit here and talk about why the Middle East is so messed up because we divided the Arabs, right? So borders are not natural, right? And there wasn't going to be a good way to divide them up, right? Back after World War I. And, you know, it wasn't simply done in European capitals either. You know, a lot of those borders are actually influenced by the people on the ground. You know, the borders of Iraq aren't the borders that were drawn up in Versailles. There's one Sykes-Picot line of Iraq, but the rest of it is all sort of, you know, tribes fighting with each other and fighting against the different countries to sort of develop these borders. Whichever way we do it, it's going to have some sort of fissures and issues, right? There's no magic borders that we're going to be able to create. Now, they might create new ones,
right?
And I think they probably will. I think the borders we're seeing now aren't going to be the borders we see in the future. But I guess what I'm saying is I don't think that's going to solve the problems that are emanating out of the Middle East, because there'll still be other issues that need to get that worked out. Mostly, I think, you know, as was said, you know, economic issues and social issues, which are going to have to, and religious issues, which are going to have to be dealt with. It's not going to be the borders that fixes it.
Good. All right. Back over here.
I just have a question about, I read recently that Assad was getting his oil from ISIS. Mm-hmm. Now, that sort of brings a question, because these are enemies, and Iran has a lot of oil, and supposedly Iran is his friend. So my question, to get to cut to the quick, the gorilla in the room is Iran. Mm-hmm. On the short haul, this is a godsend for Iran. It's destabilizing the Sunnis, it's destabilizing the whole region, it's taking the spotlight off of Iran. So could you give me an idea, is there any playing under the sheets between Iran and ISIS? And is ISIS a false flag for Iran? Iran's played games with Sunni radicals before. So the question is, what's Iran's role in this mess?
The conversation is getting very spicy. We were talking about autoeroticism, and now we're talking about people underneath the sheets. So let's talk about the problem of Iran. Andrew, what do you think about Iran and the region?
Well, there's a lot to say there. But I mean, just in terms of, you know, in terms of its relationship with the Assad regime and with the Islamic State. I mean, the relationship between the Islamic State and the Syrian regime is not a friendly one by any means. They're constantly attacking each other, although their focus sometimes goes in other directions. Actually, oftentimes goes in other directions. But in terms of oil and even more importantly than that, electricity and running electricity factories or facilities, that's really where there is actually this kind of Faustian bargain of some sort of cooperation between the two. And, you know, I think Iran understands, you know, the Assad regime's desire to play that game in order to keep the lights on, in order to administer services and things that are going to keep partisans on their side and from, you know, defecting elsewhere or from fleeing from the places that they control. And so I think, you know, on that front, I guess the point I'm making in terms of the larger relationship is that the Islamic State-Syrian government relationship is happening because of the proximity, because of the local resources and those kinds of things. And that is a slightly separate situation or relationship from Iran. That's not to say that Iran is not, you know, a part of this mix.
Can I just add two things to that real
sure.
quick?
Sure, go ahead.
First, on the issue, this hasn't been good for Iran, this Syrian civil war. Iran had allies in this, among Arab Sunni Islamists, among Muslim Brotherhood, among Hamas was a sort of Iranian proxy almost at one point. And because of this Syrian civil war, those are gone. You know, the Sunni Arabs, even the Islamists, have basically, they don't want anything to do with Iran anymore. They do, but they can't cooperate. Now, there are these sort of rumors, I think, not about Iranian, but about Assad, turning the other way about the Islamic State. I think I wasn't quite sure what to think about these rumors, but you know, a guy who just gave a book talk at FPRI, Will McCants, has a really good book, and I would trust what he says on the Islamic State. And in the book, he says that you know this is one of the reasons the Islamic State was able to sort of establish is because Assad wanted to have them fighting against the sort of more moderate fronts, right? If you're Assad, you want to have the enemy being the Islamic State. You don't want it to be some, you know, more moderate forces among the Syrian population. So the Islamic State did play a sort of functional role. There's an argument that the Islamic State played a functional role for Assad, and he understood that and allowed it to sort of flourish because of that.
I mean, there are two things really operating there that are the
it's
benefit of the
things,
of the Assad regime, and Sam hits on one of them perfectly, which is this kind of you know, that this additional player in the Islamic State that is now fighting predominantly against a lot of the other rebels, and therefore, you know, Assad can let them kind of fight amongst themselves quite a bit. And so there's kind of a distraction factor there, where the Assad regime is not targeted to the same extent that it otherwise would be. The second part of that is that it fits perfectly into the Assad regime's narrative, right? That it's fighting terrorists who are ruthless butchers who are much worse than, you know, any other possible alternative. And under this kind of light of terrorism, you know, he engages in the incredible kinds of atrocities that Sam mentioned earlier, that really, you know, that make some of the things that the Islamic State does, or at least the extent to which their violence causes damage, pale in comparison.
All right. Question from the audience back there.
Cooperation with Saudi Arabia and other authoritarian regimes in the area has been given up until this point because of a variety of reasons, particularly security and stability, though. Should we re-examine the way that we conduct these relationships in the future and the degree to which we are willing to support them, given the adverse effects in terms of public support and public opinion of the United States, and how it kind of fails to set up a long-term set of goals and a way to get to them?
Mm-hmm. Tally Helfont, our freedom-loving friends in Saudi Arabia, should we be rethinking our relationship?
I mean, I think if you want to have allies in the region, slim pickings. So you have to identify what are your key priorities and who you can work with, and constantly do a gut check and constantly reevaluate that relationship, and not do it because of precedent and not do it because you're friends, because you're not friends. But try and identify who you can work with. Now, I would say that the current administration's policy of dividing up really contentious issues into individual files in which or silos where we have these are our allies and these are our adversaries on this issue, but then it's mixed up on another issue. I don't really see that to be the way that countries in the Middle East or beyond are playing the field. So I don't think that that part makes sense. But I do think that if you look at resources, if you look at key players in the region, at the moment, it's important to retain the Saudi-American strategic relationship. Not at all costs, but for now, I do think it's worth retaining.
So we have about 5 minutes to go, so a question in the front here.
I wanted to ask you a little bit more about Jordan. I did spend some time there, and it seemed to me that the people who lived in community, the tribal people, and then the people who didn't live in community had a very major ability to exist together in a way that is successful. Is that possible anywhere else in the Middle East?
Can I ask you, what do you mean by in community and not in community?
The tribal people live like in a community separate mm-hmm. from the city people. Or
gotcha.
I don't know how to better explain.
Sure. Well, I mean, you have similar, demographic and social constructs in all sorts of other places where you have highly urban centers where you have the majority of these countries' populations, and then you have the more rural, predominantly tribal people. And you know, so I mean, I see that, you know, across the region. One of the interesting things to note just about tribes and how they function is that tribes today are very different than tribes of the past under this new urbanization, mm-hmm. right? I mean, throughout the Middle East, these large cities, vast cities, with the bulk of the population of each of these countries is a relatively new kind of phenomenon, but the tribes actually operate within that kind of urban environment as well. And so, yes, I mean, I think that the social fabric and the tribal networks that are provided by the culture of the area, can lend themselves, you know, in very positive and productive ways, but they can also underlie a lot of the patronage and corruption and things that people don't like about their government systems. And so I think this is what a lot of these countries are trying to work out at present.
So we have time for one last question from the audience. And I will say we've gone for over an hour, and there's one topic that hasn't come up, and I want to see whether you ask it, David. If you don't, we'll find out afterwards.
No, probably not. When we heard the gentleman who spoke on the ISIS apocalypse recently, I asked him whether he had any hopes at all for the Arab world. And first he laughed, and then he said, well, Tunisia has some good things to say for it, which I took, that answer I took to say he doesn't have much hope. The one thing that's bothered me in this discussion, and it's typical of these Middle East discussions, there are peoples in the Middle East and states that really function, that really do things for their people. Israel, we were talking about the Kurds. I mean, they have a functioning state. They have a history. They fight for themselves. We have this guy in Egypt now. He's not to my taste, but he has told the people in Al-Azhar that they've got to clean up their act, that there is all of this ugly hatred in Islam that has to be cleaned up. Why aren't these the people that we support? Why do we pussyfoot around this? Why is it, I really don't get it.
It's a good question. I'd like to, as a way to wrap up the conversation, I'd love to have a response and a general thought about hope and fear in the Middle East from each of the three people. I'll start with Tally. Sorry, Tally.
I guess I would say that I am a pessimist with occasional bouts of optimism. I don't know. I think it is innately American to want to look for hope. And so I guess I subscribe to that. And I think that, I guess I think about it from the perspective of being a parent. And you think, when is going to be the next generation that has the kinds of opportunities to, if you are an artist or you want to be a doctor, you can pursue that without fear of, you know, where is your meal coming from? You're going to be abducted in the middle of the night or you're going to be bombed from the sky. I don't know when that's going to be. I think that, you know, prior to the Arab uprisings, there were some positive steps in developing civil society and whatnot in certain other countries. Now, is it two steps forward, sometimes three steps back? Yes, but I guess my interactions with Middle Easterners, which I guess you could, the caveat would be, maybe I'm only interacting with certain types of Middle Easterners, but there's a lot of people who want a lot of, you know, they just want a good life and, you know, want a life without violence. So I think that hopefully that will happen for them. I guess I have to retain some optimism. And hopefully, you know, countries like the United States and other countries and countries that are functioning better in the region can help support that.
Good. Andrew Spath.
So I don't know. I think about it kind of like a zoom lens that you can go in and out. And in terms of the way my zoom lens functions, kind of like a reverse Monet, right? Where from a distance it's really ugly, but up close it, you know, there's a lot of, that's beautiful there. There's a lot that's like functioning and happening that's really nice. And I think the more that I read like news headlines and just pay attention to the general discourse, the more pessimistic I feel and the worse I see the region and all of that. But then when I go to the kind of local news sources and the Arabic news sources and watch videos on YouTube that people produce or young political activists or civil activists produce or artists and the kind of work that they produce, even in the context of mass destruction, I mean, with buildings falling down and all sorts of other things, the kind of just daily life that goes on, you know, not to minimize, you know, what they're facing at all, but the kind of daily life that they're able to carry through and the kinds of things that they produce in that kind of context is quite amazing to me. And so, yeah, in terms of my general outlook on it, I guess that's how I'd see it.
All right. Sam Helfont, bring us home.
I'm a complete pessimist. I think the destruction that's occurred in sort of Fertile Crescent over the last 10 years, it's going to take generations to heal. Saudi Arabia is a time bomb, as are, you know, many other places. But I would respond to say that I don't know what else you would expect the U.S. to do to help, you know, those groups that you mentioned. I mean, Israel, okay, the political leaderships don't get along, but Israel has received more, you know, military aid than ever before, you know, the last decade or so. The Kurds are there because the U.S. is supporting them. Sisi was a more complicated issue because he came to power in a coup and U.S. losses were not allowed to help people who do that. But, you know, quietly, he's now getting everything he wants. It's not, you know, in the press, and but you know, all his military demands. He was wanted Apache helicopters and all this other, you know, equipment, and he's getting it all. He's getting all of it now.
Shouldn't we say that to tell, in other words, tell the others that that's what we're doing? In other words, why is it surreptitious or behind closed doors?
Well, there's a lot of complications. I mean, when we help the Kurds, a lot of times we're helping an organization that we have said is a terrorist, right?
And I say we talk too much. We declare what we're going to do all the time. Nobody else does that. It's a bad idea. It's better that they're, you know, let's wait for the archives. Let's do the right thing or do the smart thing and then find out about it later.
That's right.
The famous phrase for when you make a film, it's show it, don't tell it, right? So that we need to, American foreign policy needs to show better than tell. I want to say, in case you were wondering, you were all sitting on the edge of seats wondering what topic didn't come up in an hour-long discussion on the Middle East.
Israel
never came up once, which, however, I will say, Israel, that's right, you did bring it up, but I will say this is a sign both of the richness of the topic and also the potential for future events of the Foreign Policy Research Institute that we hope you will also choose to come to. For tonight, however, I'm going to let the president say a word to you, but I just wanted to say, for my part, thank you very much for your attention. Thanks very much to Sam Helfont, Tally Helfont, and Andrew Spath for your participation. Well done, everybody.
And I would just add to that, thank you, Ron, for moderating this exciting discussion. I think this is the only audience, however, where the questions are as good as the answers, so I want to thank all of you for joining us. I hope to see you soon next year. We are right now putting together our entire spring calendar. We ought to have all the details lined up within a week or so. I will tell you, for our bronze partners, we have an annual brunch on April 17th, and we have lined up Marty Morse Cohane of WHYY to interview, as she does on her show, a team of panelists that will include Trudy Rubin of the Philadelphia Inquirer, and then one of our scholars still to be selected. So I hope you will sign up for that. I am carrying membership forms. If anybody is not a member, I hope you will join us and have a great new year, a happy and healthy new year, and see you next year.